Shout it from the mountaintops. Make it echo off canyon walls. Let it ride on every wave. Let it soar on wings of a dove. Plant it deep in your hearts. Sing it over and over. Christ the Lord is risen today.
Thank you.
us pray together. God of the morning light, God of Easter miracles, open our hearts to hear once again the story of love overcoming death, of joy drowning out sorrow, of hope emerging from despair. Bring Easter to this moment. Touch us and fill us with the risen Christ. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Was that interlude music or something? Did I hear a nasty rumor? Did I hear you're moving? Yes, I did. We're going to lose Rochelle. She's been such a faithful member, and she sang in our Pilgrim Singers, and I enjoyed visiting with her, and I didn't enjoy all the problems we got you through, though. How about that? Boy, brought you back from Resurrection City, I think, with all our prayers. Well, I want you to take something with you that you can remember us by. You know, when you get up north, you can get somebody to help you go online, and you can watch the services on our website. You know that? So I want you to be able to sing along because you like to sing. So we have your very own hymnal, just like ours, and it says, "This hymnal is given to our dear friend Rochelle Boyd by her friends at the Congregational Church, Summerfield, Florida." We love you. Thank you. Now I've got to see if I can get through here. Watch your tootsies. Here we go. There we go. All right. Now, if we have any children here, I mean, most of us have regressed to that, but Billy, send your girls up here. Are they too bashful? You can come up too. I want to do it. That's what I told my wife this morning when she said I had to get up at 4:30. I don't want to do it. Just sit down on the floor right here. That's good. And if you can come up and sit with her if you want to. There we go. Hi, sweetie. Aren't you pretty today? Wow. What a pretty dress. Yeah. It's all right. You don't have to. You don't have to. You're close enough to see. Okay. I want to tell you that today is Easter. And on Easter, ooh, I like your shoes. Oh, they're so pretty. They're very colorful. Okay. On Easter, Jesus is taken down from the cross. On Good Friday, he's taken down from the cross, and he's put in this tomb. And this is like a model of the tomb. They put him in the tomb, and they roll the stone in front of the door, like that. And so Jesus is in the tomb. And when Jesus goes in the tomb, he's kind of like this ducky. This ducky is not alive, is it? No. This is just an inanimate object. This is just a stuffed ducky. You want to see the ducky? You can check it out for your very self. There's no trick, nothing up my sleeve. That ducky is not alive. Right? There you go. All right, now watch what we're going to do with this stuff. See? Just as they put Jesus when he was passed away, when he died, they put him in the tomb and they closed the door. What happens on Easter Sunday? On Easter Sunday, the angels came and rolled the stone back, and Jesus came out of the tomb. But was he still dead? No, he wasn't dead anymore. When Jesus came out of the tomb, he was alive. Yeah. you see him? You want to see him? Well, after what he did to me last year, I didn't want to see him either. But now, something funny about duckies. You heard how he was hollering? Doesn't like to be out by himself. So when Jesus died, he tells the disciples, it's important that I go away. He's going back to God, his Father. Because if I go away, I'm going to send you another comforter, who is the Holy Spirit. And once the Holy Spirit comes, then we've got God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. And so that's how I keep my duckies quiet when I do this, because we've got them all. They're the Trinity Trio. Okay. So I don't know if anybody likes that or not, but I do it every year because I love it. I don't really care if you like it or not. Thank you. I think this year we escaped without any additional stuff. So. And I also wanted to tell you that after church, since we're done with all this, once a minister gets done talking, then we're all going to go out those doors and out front, and you're going to get an envelope, and in the envelope is a butterfly. And the reason we do the butterflies is because a butterfly comes out of a cocoon, sort of like Jesus came out of the tomb. So we get a caterpillar, goes in and weaves a cocoon around himself, and he's kind of lifeless in there. And gradually something called metamorphosis takes place, and his wings form, and he breaks through the cocoon, and out he comes and flies away. So we have butterflies on Easter because of that. It's almost like resurrection. So everybody, there's, I think, one for everybody, but might be one per couple. And also, I forgot to say this during the announcements because my brain has not yet been resurrected. If you look in your bulletin, some of you have a little purple star. Little purple star. How many got a little purple star? Wave your hands. Okay. All right. Those of you who have a little purple star, you've just won a brand new car. No, you didn't. No, you didn't. Carl, the chairman of my board, just had a heart attack right here in front of me. No, actually, what happens is after we do the butterflies, we're going to have you come back in after the butterflies. If you have one of those, bring it back in and wait right here, and I'll have some people here. And you get one of these plants. My way of getting rid of the plants and blessing you at the same time. So if you got a purple star, come back in after that. And you can have your choice as long as choices last. Okay? All right. Are we ready for He Lives? Let's stand and sing together, He Lives, Christ Jesus Lives Today. I serve a risen Savior. Thank you. So much, you may be seated. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Raise us, O God, from the pits that threaten to imprison us. Help us find a way out. Open the doors of our tombs, small and large, and hasten the day when we walk as risen people, able to live fully in your magnificent and sure salvation. Christ has died and risen that we might be forgiven and live again. For our forgiveness through the sacrifice of Jesus, we thank you, Father. Amen. Christ is risen. Our loads are lifted. The path is cleared. Light rises over us as Jesus overcomes darkness and death. We need not struggle alone, pushing through pain, stumbling on sin, trying to walk life's way unaided. Lent is over, Easter has come, and our day, our road, is new. We are forgiven. Jesus leads the way. With you. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, what an amazing thing it must have been to be with those women who ran to the tomb that morning and found that Jesus was no longer there, that he was not dead, that he was alive. What an amazing thing for those who walked with him on the road to Emmaus, or the disciples by the sea. There, the living Christ, the one who occupies even this place today, was alive and well and filled with power and wonder. Today we have come to worship him, not to deify an empty tomb, not to just hear an old story, but to believe that this living Christ, the Son of Almighty God, is with us, loving us, caring for us, reshaping and remolding us, making us into what he desires us to be. And we are so very, very grateful. Today, Heavenly Father, we bring to your throne of grace those that are on our hearts or going through tough times. We pray for those who grieve at the loss of loved ones. We pray for those who are going through sickness and illness, that you might give them healing. We pray for all those who are confused or hurting or going through financial difficulty. You are the source. You are the resurrection power. You are the one who calls us forth from the darkest of tombs to the brightest of lights. Help us, Heavenly Father, to trust, to believe, to put our hand in yours, and walk forward into the future in your love and light. For we pray these things in the name of your Son, who taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have a prayer shawl, and if you're visiting, what we do is people make these beautiful prayer shawls, and we dedicate them in our services, pray over them, and then we take them out to folks who are going through a tough time. Sometimes people are sick, or they're grieving, or they just need some encouragement. And today this prayer shawl is going out to Linda Van Dam, who's lost her mother, and this was requested by Jesse and Jeff's sister's daughter. Is that right? Get that right? So we want to pray for her. Could a couple people come up, please? Gracious Heavenly Father, it's so difficult to lose a loved one, to let go, even though we know that they are with you and wonder and majesty and glory is theirs, not ours. So we pray for this family, each and every one of them, at the loss of this dear sister, that you would be with them and encourage them, send your Holy Spirit to them, give them just what they need, especially Linda, as she goes through this awful time. We pray these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
So in your programs, it says the next hymn is, Were You There? Well, it's not. You know that business about women having the prerogative to change their minds? Well, I did. Anyway, I learned this song about a year ago to sing for a celebration of life. I love what it says, and the gentleman who had passed also loved it. And so he requested that I sing it for him. And so for Bob and for all of you, here is To God Be the Glory. Whoop. For the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you gave to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am or ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory. To God he has done. With his blood, he has saved me. With his power, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. Just let me live my life and let it be pleasing, Lord, to thee. And if I gain any praise, let it go to Calvary. With his blood, he has saved me. With his power, he has raised me. To God be the glory for the things he has done. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things, for the things he has done. With his power, he has saved me. To God be the glory for the things, for the things he has done. He has Heavenly Father, for the fulfillment of the promise seen in the resurrection of your Son from the dead, we worship you and praise you. And as an act of thanksgiving, we bring to you these our gifts, and we ask that you would bless them and each of us, that your Son's work might continue, that the knowledge that there is hope, that there is possibility, that there is the love of Christ available to all would be spread from this place around the world. In his name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Our reading today is Luke Chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground. But the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee, 'The Son of Man must be delivered over to the hands of sinners, be crucified, and on the third day be raised again.'" Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the others with them, who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb. Bending over, he saw the strips of linen lying by themselves. And he went away, wondering to himself, what had happened? This is the end of our reading of our Holy Scripture this morning.
Go ahead, drive the nails in my hands, laugh at me where you stand. Go ahead and say it isn't me. The day will come when you will see. 'Cause I'll rise again. There ain't no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead, mock my name, my love for you is still the same. Go ahead and bury me. Very soon I will be free. 'Cause I'll rise again. There ain't no power on earth can tie me down. Yes, I'll rise again. Death can't keep me in the ground. Go ahead and say I'm dead and gone, but you will see that you were wrong. Go ahead, try to hide hide the sun, but all will see that I'm the one, 'cause I'll come again. There ain't no power on earth can keep me back. Yes, I'll come again. Come to take my people back. Oh, I'll come again. There ain't no power on earth can hold me back. Yes, I'll come again. Come to take my people back. Come to take my children home. Say
this little introit with me, please. I am building my life on the promises of God, because His word is unbreakable. My hope is unshakable. I do not stand on the problems of life or the pain of life. I stand on the great and precious promises of God. Thank you so much. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O God. Well, Easter, resurrection. These are things that are kind of foreign to a lot of our culture anymore. Easter is Palmer Candies from Reading, Pennsylvania, where I grew up, the multi-million-dollar business making chocolate bunnies and marshmallow chicks and all kinds of goodies. Easter is a commercial enterprise. Christmas is a commercial enterprise. And we've taken these Christmas holidays. And you realize that the reason we still have these, the reason they haven't been taken away by a culture that feels like we're pushing our religion on somebody by celebrating these holidays, the reason is because they're economically advantageous to certain businesses. It's true. If all of a sudden you stop buying Christmas presents and running up your charge accounts, or you stop going down to Walgreens and buying all that wonderful Palmer and Hershey candy from Pennsylvania, all of a sudden you would find a whole upsurge of people trying to eliminate these holidays, these Christian festivals that you and I have grown so fond of and that are so dear to our lives and so important to us. The resurrection, Easter, is the most central point in our Christian faith. If Christ is not risen from the dead, says the Apostle Paul, then our preaching is in vain. And we are above all men most foolish. The whole idea of our faith rests on a living Savior. It rests on the fact that Jesus walked out of that tomb, and because He walked out of that tomb, you and I cannot be held by the grave. Because He walked out of that tomb, you and I cannot be kept in our sins or our addictions or our problems. We have the opportunity to live resurrection life. That's the promise of Christian faith. And that's what Easter is all about. It solidifies all the teachings. It guarantees all the writings that you and I have the opportunity to live. And that God has sent His Son in love, not as a warrior, but as a lover. He sent Him to care for us, to sacrifice Himself for us, to give Himself 100% everything, to sacrifice Himself for you and I. What an amazing concept. No world leader, no political leader, no monarch. No one in all of world history was willing to do what Jesus of Nazareth did just for you and just for me. And he was able to do that by promising us that no matter who we were or what we're like or what church we belong to or what denomination we are part of, or maybe we're not even a Christian at all, he died for us. Did you know that? Before a person becomes a Christian, before he acknowledges Christ, before he joins some church or subscribes to some doctrinal position, Jesus died for that person. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Not me saying it, it's what the Bible says. God loves us so much that he sends his son to die, whether we believe in him or not, whether we're ready to accept or not. Jesus dies to demonstrate the greatest love the world has ever known, thereby drawing us to himself and drawing us to that love. And once we're drawn to him, he begins a process. And that process is what I want to talk about this morning. Restoration, rehabilitation, and finally, resurrection, resurrection power. Jesus is a life changer. Jesus is a force and a power and a dynamic that was sent to totally revamp your life. Doesn't matter what part of the planet you come from. It doesn't matter what language you speak. It doesn't matter what your background or your history is. Jesus came to change lives, to make our lives better, to be the force and the power behind life-changing matters. And so the life giver, the resurrected Jesus, is a life changer for you. And he is a life changer. And I mentioned this earlier when I was talking to the kids about the butterflies out a little later, that it's that concept of we are a nasty looking caterpillar. I mean, not just physically nasty looking, but we're nasty looking in our behavior, in our attitudes, in our selfishness, in our concentration on our problems being the biggest problems there are, to the detriment of anybody else who might have a problem. We are that nasty little slimy looking caterpillar. And Jesus comes and he wraps us in his love. He wraps us in his concern. He encircles us with his caring. And eventually we are in this cocoon. We are wrapped up in Jesus. And then gradually the promise becomes real. And we break through the threads. We break through every thread that's every sin, every bad thought, every mistake we've made, every addiction that we've had. We break through all of that with the power that's set loose by Jesus himself. And we all of a sudden realize we're not that nasty caterpillar anymore. Instead, we've got beautiful wings and we can fly. Somebody once said to me, you know, when you die, you go into the grave and you sleep, and then you are resurrected. The Bible says we shall not all die, but we shall all sleep. And it says when he returns that we shall rise to meet him in the air. And they said, oh, what do you think is going to happen when you die? And I said, well, I'm hoping and I'm thinking that I'm not going to die until Jesus comes back. That way I don't have to pay for an expensive casket and embalming and I'm basically doing this because I'm cheap, you see. So I said, my thought is that I'm not going to die. I'm going to fly. So when he comes back, that's my plan. I hope it works out that way. So like a beautiful caterpillar, I might get rid of this nasty, chubby little body, and I might get some wings. I probably won't if you don't stop buying me peanut butter cups. But anyway, we are restored. God had a plan for you. He had a plan for your life. He still does. He's still holding on to that plan. It's in the file cabinet up in heaven with a file with your name on it. And you are part of God's plan. He's going to do amazing things with you. He's going to help change the world one person at a time, your kids, your grandkids, your community, the church you belong to or that you go to on a regular basis, the school that you volunteer at. He's going to change the world around you using you. You are part of what he's going to do. To do that, he's got to restore you to the original plan. Now, if you've got a computer, you know that sometimes your computer goes down, and if you've got that little memory stick, or used to be at a floppy disk, you see how old I am. Remember Tandy computers? So you put that in there, and you can renew all the memory and all the stuff that was on that computer before, even if it's all lost. And I believe that God's got a memory stick up there, a restoration stick, and he restores you to the defaults, only it won't be your fault anymore. So you will be what God intended you to be. You will be restored, and you're restored by the very presence of Jesus Christ, by his power. You are restored to what God intends you to be, not what you want to be. You know, we restore a lot of things in this world. We restore cars. There's a great show on television where they take these old beat up cars and they restore them with original parts and original color paint. And they look just like the day they were pulled off the showroom back in 1954. I mean, they're just beautiful cars. And then you have people like the Gaineses from Texas who take an old house, an old beat up house, and they pour a whole bunch of money into it and they restore that house. And the house looks like gorgeous, you know, like a brand new home with probably better than new. So those things are restoration projects. And God's going to take you, a beat up old jalopy, a rundown old shack, and he's going to turn you into a beautiful Jaguar XKE from 1958. And he's going to make you look like one of those millionaire lifestyle houses in the villages. He can restore anything. He's going to restore Notre Dame Cathedral. Now, people have already offered millions of dollars, $1 billion, I believe, has been touted around. And they're going to restore it to the way it was. My prayer is that they don't get a bunch of architects from around the world who come up with some crazy new modernistic design, but that they restore it the way it was. They restore it maybe the way God intended it and it was built in the first place. And so I hope that that restoration is right, just like I hope your restoration is right. It doesn't take $1 million to fix you, although some of the ladies would like that, but it doesn't take $1 million to fix you. It just takes love and care and concern and a purpose, and you'll be all right. Jesus restores our life. So one of the things that Easter's all about is restoring us, giving us the power to be what God intended us to be. Think about that. What am I supposed to be? Who am I supposed to be? Where am I supposed to go? Who am I supposed to affect? That is what Jesus came and died and rose again to give us, the power to be restored. He heals the brokenhearted. He binds up our wounds. He makes us whole again. He takes us and he puts back in that restore stick, and he puts back all the memory that needs to be there. Jesus restores. Also, Jesus rehabilitates us. You know, there's all kinds of rehab centers all over this area because of our age and our propensity for having strokes and health issues and so forth. My mother, I think, held the world's record for being in Freedom Point. I think she was there like 8 times. I was convinced that she liked being around Freedom Point more than she liked being around me. So, and actually, it's because of Freedom Point that I met this young lady back here, because she came to volunteer and play her chimes one day. And I was walking by, and we had chimes at my church up in Michigan. So I went in and I started talking to her, and I went down to the room and I said, "Mom, come hear the chimes." And I don't want to do that. I said, "Sure you do." "No, I don't want to do that." So I said, "Get in the wheelchair." I said, "I'm the boss now. You're the kid. I'm the boss." So I made her go down, and she loved it. She loved Harriet, and she loved the music, and she sat there and tapped her foot to the whole thing. And I asked Harriet afterwards, I said, "Could you come to our church and do that?" She said, "Sure." So she came, and she never left. So rehab centers do some good, and Harriet's one of the wonderful things that rehab did. Rehab doesn't always work, though, you see, because you have to have something there to bring back. Remember, I said to be restored, you've got to have an original restoration target. You have to have original default information. Well, a rehab requires that too. You're trying to bring this person back to some semblance of the activity level or what they were before. So it's important. A friend of mine was a counselor and did work at the county, huge county jail up in Michigan in Oakland County. And he was faced day in and day out with all sorts of folks who made terrible mistakes with their lives. And so I asked him one day, I said, you know, you're not in the church anymore. You're doing this counseling at the jail and you're meeting with these prisoners. And so I said, how's that going? Are you having any effect? And he kind of hung his head a little bit and he said, well, let me tell you, you can't rehabilitate that which ain't been habilitated in the first place. I tell you that to say that it's awfully important that every grandma, every mom, every dad, every neighbor, every friend, every Boy Scout leader, Girl Scout leader, church youth group leader, everybody who has the opportunity to touch the lives of children, provide the input that provides the habilitation so that someday down the road when Jesus rehabilitates, when Jesus brings them to his full, their full stature in him, they'll be remembering and they'll be bringing back what you have inputted into their lives. The Bible says, train up a child while he is young, and when he becomes old, he will not depart from it. Okay? So rehabilitation is part of what Jesus does. No temptation has overcome you except that which is common to mankind. So in other words, all the problems that you have, all the mistakes that you make, the dumb addictions that you let yourself get a part of, all the things that go wrong in your life, you're not peculiar. Well, you may be a little peculiar, but you're not peculiar, okay? You are just like everybody else on this planet. Everybody is just like you when it comes to these things. All mankind, it says. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. Now, of all the scriptures, this one bothers me the most because I think to myself every time I hear it, if that's true, that he will not allow me to be tempted beyond what I can bear, then his opinion of me must be way too high, right? I mean, haven't you been tempted beyond and above and down the road a piece? I mean, and if God thinks that this is okay, he must have all kinds of confidence in you. You know what he's doing? He's seeing you restored. He's looking at you as the original, as you were intended to be. He's seeing you as the rehabilitated one. He's seeing you in your full habilitation. He's seeing you as the person that he designed and made, the one he knew in your mother's womb while you were still there, as you were being formed. That's the God, and that's the person who he sees. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. What is the way out? The way out is Jesus. The way out is the cross. And it's not a doctrine. It's not a denomination. It's the Son of God. It's everything he represents. It's the man and his love. It's the man and his concern. It's the man and his ability to overlook the sins of others. It's the man who could still say to Peter, even though he knew he would deny him, even though he knew he would lop the ear off the temple guard, even though he knew Peter was a hothead, he'd say to him, on you, rock, I'm going to build my church. He could love Peter in spite of himself, and he loves you in spite of yourself, and he loves me in spite of myself too. So the cross, the Word of God, are the directions. They're the input. They're the things God uses, part of the things God uses to rehabilitate and to restore us. How does all this empower? You know, you can put that memory stick into your computer. You can turn on that 80-inch, I think they have 80-inch TVs now. You can turn on that 80-inch TV with your Comcast box underneath it that costs you $260 a month. Did you ever notice that when we were kids, we had I was just talking to somebody about this past week, and they shared a similar experience. We had a tenorotor, and it had this little gauge, and you turned it, and if you wanted Lancaster, you turned it a little bit until it cleared up. And if you wanted Philadelphia, you turn a little bit more. And if you wanted Harrisburg, you turn it this way. Well, when I was in college, we lived in a trailer. And so we didn't have a tenor rotor. I couldn't afford a tenor rotor. So we just had the antenna on a pole. And so if I wanted to get Harrisburg or I wanted to get down toward Gettysburg, I had to go out the back door, climb up on the oil tank, climb up on the garden shed, climb up on the roof of the trailer, run the 60 feet down to the thing, turn it, yell in the window, "How's that?" Three channels. And there was always something to watch. Now, I've got 793 channels and there's never anything on. Gosh, and it costs you a fortune, doesn't it? So go figure. But anyway, if you have that great system and all those channels and all that, it doesn't do a bit of good if you don't plug it in. If there's no power, it doesn't work. If there's no power in your life, the rehabilitation, the memory stick, the restoration, all the attending church, all the boards you serve on, all the things that you read from Max Lucado to Billy Graham to whatever, all that stuff doesn't do a thing unless it's empowered, unless it's got power behind it, resurrection power behind it. And that's what Easter's all about. Easter is believing and knowing and accepting anew the power that God used to burst forth that Jesus, that Son of his, out of that tomb into resurrection life. I mean, can you imagine how much energy and power it would take to roll the stone away, throw off the grave clothes, create a beautiful glowing white remnant and bring him forth out of that tomb, pew, into resurrection life, and then bring him back to appear to the disciples? That's power. That's energy. And it takes that kind of power and that kind of energy, that kind of resurrection power to change us, to change us. Oh, we think we know everything. And, you know, religion is a mess. I mean, you've got people fighting over, well, I'm a Baptist. Well, I'm a Lutheran. Well, I'm an Episcopalian. I can hardly even say it. You got all these different groups and people, you ask them what they actually will say, I am a Lutheran. I am an Assembly of God. I am a Pentecostal. I want to say, oh, really? I'm just a Christian. I'm just a believer in Jesus. And, you know, and then they've got these lists of doctrines. All of it is death. All of it is just so much verbiage and so much impossible to follow rules and regulations that the world in general just wipes their hands of it and says, forget it. Forget it. I can't do it. But resurrection power allows us to live, to be restored, to be rehabilitated, to be what God intended us to be. He is risen. Because he lives, we too shall live. Because the power brought him out of the rock, out of the tomb, from death, off the grave shelf, it can do the same for you. Some people get to the place in their life where they feel like they have no power left. Their job is gone and the kids are grown. And, you know, I mean, their day amounts to going out on the golf course five times a week and embarrassing themselves. You know, I mean, when it all gets down to that, trust me, you need Jesus bad. His sacrifice, his wounds, his blood bought us the opportunity. What a shame if we wouldn't take it. What a wasted opportunity if we wouldn't seize it. That tomb opens up, the power brings him out, and that power says to us, we don't have to be locked in that tomb anymore either. We can be alive forevermore. These things have I spoken to you that you might have peace. In the world, you'll have tribulation, you'll have trouble, you'll have problems, you'll have addictions, you'll get married to the wrong person, you'll join the wrong church, you'll go on Easter Sunday and the guy's going to talk way too long before you get a butterfly. I mean, you know, you just can't win sometimes, you know? But be of good cheer. He's overcome the world. He's overcome the world. Take heart. I have overcome the world, he promised. And he will let you overcome the world too. Because he lives. Because he lives. He's so cute. Aw. I like your shoes. Yeah, yeah. It's okay. It's all right. I'm done. One day, most of you weren't here, but we were still over at the Methodist Church. And my little granddaughter, we baptized her that day. And at the end of the sermon, everything was real quiet like this. And in the back, she goes. She's like, oh, is she like 1.5 or something like that? Kid was smarter than you people. Anyway, because he lives, I can face tomorrow because all fear is gone. Jesus is alive. He is risen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for Easter, for the joy that it brings, for the hope that it gives us, and for the fact that we are not dead and we shall not be dead. We shall live as he does. Because he lives, we too shall live and face tomorrow. Amen. The presence of God surrounds you. The love of God enfolds you. The power of God protects you. Wherever you are, wherever you go, whatever you do, there God is. Thanks so much for coming. Happy Easter.